Why are we here on Earth? Where does life come from? These are questions you most likely all asked yourself before, at least once in your life. For example, when you lie in bed and you cannot sleep, these questions might pop up into your head. My name is Marcel Eleveld, and I am a bit weird, because I ask myself these questions every single day. And because of that, I decided to study the origin of life in my PhD research. And what fascinates me so much about the origin of life is, well, first of all, the incredible complexity of life. We can make all the most difficult, complex things, like, for example, this church or planes or whatever, but nothing comes close to the complexity of only one single cell. And another thing that goes hand in hand with this complexity is the incredible unlikeliness of life coming into existence in the first place. To illustrate this, I would like to tell you the chances of one single cell forming from what was present on the Earth billions of years ago. The chances of this happening are roughly similar to having a scrapyard that is completely filled with parts of cars, planes, trains, bicycles, you name it. Then a tornado comes along, and the tornado assembles out of this mess a complete Boeing 747. I think we can all agree that the chances of this happening are incredibly low. But the fact that we are all sitting here today, being alive, is proof that it is actually possible. Okay, before I continue, I would like to address the elephant in the room here. Because all my friends and family started laughing when I told them that I was going to talk about the origin of life here in the great church in Alkmaar, in the house of God. But I would like to emphasize that I study how life could have formed from its components, and whether you believe this could have happened on itself with an incredible amount of luck, or that there must have been a helping hand of a divine being, I would like to leave this up to you to decide for yourself. Okay, the origin of life. But what is life, actually? I think we all know what life is, but if you really need to define it, it becomes quite difficult. But first, I would like to illustrate with you all that we are generally quite good at knowing whether something is alive or not. I would like to do a short quiz with you. My sister's cat here behind me. If you think my sister's cat is alive, I would like to ask you to stand up if you are able to. Okay. Well, I think we have an agreement, and we all say most of us think that my sister's cat is alive, and I would agree with you. Okay, then the second example, this rock. If you think this rock is alive, please stand up or keep staying. Otherwise, sit down or stay seated. Okay, I see a lot of people are sitting down now, and I would agree with the majority here that this rock is not alive. Then the last one, and after that, you don't have to stand up or sit down anymore, this virus. If you think a virus is alive, please stand up. If you think it's not, please sit down. Okay. Thank you all very much. You can all sit down again. The conclusion from this last one is that sort of half of the people here think the virus is alive and half of them think it's not. And I agree, this is actually quite difficult, but I'll come back to this example in a bit. Luckily for us, there are people who search for life, for example, in outer space. A company like NASA, for example, does this, and they need to know what they are looking for. So they have a definition. And the definition that NASA uses for life is: life is a self-sustaining chemical system capable of undergoing Darwinian evolution. Okay, this sounds like a whole lot, but it's actually not too difficult. Self-sustaining means you need to be able to keep yourself alive. Chemical system, you need to be made out of molecules. Well, we all are, so that's easy. And undergoing Darwinian evolution basically means you need to be able to reproduce and your children need to look a bit like you. Well. And according to this definition, indeed, my sister's cat is very much alive, the rock is not, And also the virus will not be alive because it cannot self-sustain. It needs another host organism to do so. Okay, now it seems we have our perfect definition now and we can start looking for the origin of life. No, we cannot. Because this definition, although it's really good, is not perfect. For example, this mule here, which is an infertile crossbreed of a horse and a donkey, cannot reproduce. Therefore, it cannot undergo Darwinian evolution and would not be alive, according to the definition. But if you would see one standing and walking around, you would definitely say that it is alive. Also, Lonesome George here, who was at some point the last of his kind, could not reproduce anymore, but he was very much alive. Okay, maybe this definition is just not really good. Let's look at another one. Something is alive when it takes up energy or matter from their environment, performs work, and excretes waste. So if you eat, you take up energy or matter from your environment. If you walk around and you heat up, for example, you perform work. And I don't think I have to explain you how excreting waste works. But according to this definition, the mule is alive. Lonesome George is also alive. But also a campfire would be alive. So also this definition is not perfect. So I think it's best if we just try to, if we just give up on trying to find the perfect definition. Instead of that, it's maybe better to just have a checklist of three important properties that all living things we know have. The first property is that almost all living things we know are able to reproduce. Reproduction is very essential for life. So this is the first criterion. The second one is that you're able to self-sustain by taking up energy from your environment. So for humans, this means as long as we are eating, we stay alive, we stay together. If we stop doing that, we die, our body falls apart, and we cannot self-sustain. Third one, being isolated from your environment. It sounds a bit silly, but it's very important that you know what is part of the thing that you call life and what is not. And in the picture here behind me, that means everything in white is part of the cat, everything in black is not. Okay, now with our checklist in hand, we know now what we are looking for, what is life, so we can start looking for it. There are two general strategies to study the origin of life. First one is the top-down strategy. You look at what we can learn from the things that are alive. So we take something from which we know for certain it's alive, my sister's cat, and then we take away all the parts that are not necessary for it to be alive, and then we see if it's still alive after we've done that. Well, if I try to take away parts of my sister's cat, I will not be alive anymore to tell you if it worked. So we take something simpler, for example, a bacterium, and yeah, that's definitely alive, but we cannot go much simpler than a bacterium. We can take away some parts, but it remains a bacterium, so this is about the simplest thing we can have. Then there is the second approach to tackle the origin of life problem, the bottom-up approach. The bottom-up approach studies what was present on the Earth 4 billion years ago, which was the primordial soup. And because meteorites hit the Earth and lightning struck the Earth out of these simple molecules that covered the Earth, the building blocks of life could have emerged. Now, going from the building blocks of life to something as complex as a bacterium, this is still a really large gap that needs to be filled. But it's very interesting to look here, because somewhere in between is the transition from not alive to alive. Yes. Okay, if you look at life, all life that we know have in common that they revolve around three key molecules. DNA. Well, we all know what DNA is. DNA contains the information that makes you you. My DNA contains the information that makes me me. And if you can visualize DNA, you can think of DNA as that every single one of your cells contains a 2 meter long string, which is a very long molecule of DNA. And this 2 meter long string, this is a shoelace, it's a bit too thick, because in reality you can fold it and it will fit in one single cell. Well, the shoelace doesn't, but real DNA does. And what happens in your body is that some small parts of the DNA are copied into RNA. And then this RNA is again copied into proteins. And proteins are the workhorses of your cells. Without proteins, nothing happens. Okay, but life, when it came into existence, of course, didn't contain all these three molecules already at the same time. The chances of that happening are incredibly low. So it most likely started with only one of them. And most people think that this must have been RNA. This is why I study RNA in my research. And you can visualize RNA as also as a string, but RNA is actually a polymer. And you might remember from chemistry in high school what a polymer is, but don't worry, I'll explain it to you again. A polymer is a very long molecule that consists out of repeating building blocks. Okay, this sounds difficult, but it's quite easy to think of it as a stack of Legos. The stack of Legos is one thing, which is then the polymer, and it's built up out of repeating units, which are the individual Lego pieces. And what you see when you look at all the RNA that you have in your body, all the pieces of Lego are stacked nicely on top of each other, like in the picture here behind me. But what happens now if I try to make a stack of Legos of RNA in the lab without the help of the proteins that are present in your cells? Because I just said we only had RNA at the beginning. Then something strange happens, because it doesn't only stack neatly on top of each other, also it stacks in the wrong way. Then you think, okay, what? Why do I care? Well, all the life that we know has very neatly stacked RNA, so this is what we try to make as well. And then what most people have done so far when they tackle this problem, they looked, okay, how can we make sure that this process goes a bit more efficient? Because the way it is now, if you try to stack the Lego pieces on top of each other, it goes right approximately 2 times, then it goes wrong once, then it goes right again 2 times, and I think you get the idea. But before we can have something functional, a piece of RNA that actually does something, we need to stack 30 on top of each other. Well, if the chances of stacking it in the right way are only 2/3, how big are the chances that you do it 30 times in a row in the right way? Well, that chance is almost not there. So what most people until now have done is they try to make this process more efficient. So let's say it goes right 3 times and then it goes wrong once. That's already quite an achievement, but nevertheless, trying to stack 30 on top of each other is next to impossible. Now, what my professor and I think, you need to take a different look, a different approach to tackle this problem. What we think is we just accept the fact that it goes wrong 1/3 of the times. But fortunately for us, under some conditions, the linkages that are made in the wrong way, so the Legos that are stacked with an offset, are less stable. So if we let it break down a little bit after we stacked everything on top of each other, we break down the wrong linkages. And we still have stacks of neatly packed pieces of RNA. Now, if we try to let these react again, it goes right once, once again, and it goes wrong once. Now, if we repeat this process many times, we can start making RNA that's actually quite long, and everything is stacked neatly on top of each other. This is the theory. If this works in practice, I don't know. I have still 4 more years to study this problem, and I hope that in 4 years I can tell you that this worked, but I don't know yet. Okay, now let's get back to where we started. How far are we? If we go back to our scrapyard, well, now not a tornado comes along, but I come along. I am the stick man with the glasses. Can I assemble a Boeing 747? Well, the answer is no. I'm not even close. I think the best I could do is make a paper-folded plane. It's nothing close to a Boeing, but let's be real here. The first plane that we ever made was also not a Boeing. It was a lot simpler. And the paper-folded plane, it starts to look a bit like a plane. It has wings and it can fly a little bit. I mean, not very much, but it starts to look like it. But there's still a lot of work to be done. But that's nice for me because it's my job to figure this out. What do I want you to do? I don't want you all to start working on the origin of life problem, because then I don't have a job anymore. The thing I want you to take home from my talk is to every once in a while appreciate the fact that you're alive, because the chances that you were here in the first place are very, very low. Thank you very much.